proceed for a panel discussion. Our first panelist for the day is Professor Dr. Martin Medvede, Head of Department of Ayurveda Medicine, European Academy of Ayurveda. Principal Scientist, IICT, to grace the place. Professor and former Additional Principal Chief Conservator of Forest of Tamil Nadu Forest Department to grace the place. Ramakrishna, Principal Scientist, IICT, to grace the place. We are Head of Department of Genetics. Kumar Verma, Principal Scientist, CCMB, to grace the place.
Good afternoon to all of you. This panel discussion was not planned, but some of the important talks which we have heard in the morning sessions and in the afternoon sessions, we all decided that we must discuss some important issues. We must involve the students sitting in this hall, and we must think about some important key issues which we are going to face, or we want to face, and which we want to find the solutions for. So, after giving a little thought and deep thought about it, everyone agreed that the discussion for the topic for the today's panel discussion would be the roadmap for the modern research on medicinal plants and Ayurvedic therapy for 2020. So you must be thinking, why not 2015 and why 2020? Right? Okay. You know, just I give you a very simple example. Like just now we had a very tasty lunch. You know? And yes, they are there, but they are dispersed. Ayurvedic doctors say, I am doing a great, and I don't want modern research to do. I'm okay, I'm full, I'm complete. And actually they are. But now the need of the time is that we must come together and think a roadmap ahead. And coming together may take and will take at least 5 years. So what this roadmap must be and what it should be, that's what this panel is going to discuss today for next 20 minutes. And maybe remaining 10 minutes we can have a discussion with all of you. And at the end of the panel discussion, we must come up with some 10 points or 15 points that will be the resolution of this meeting, and which will be communicated officially to different authorities in India. And discussion to Professor Martin, and please convene the panel discussion.
I'm in the fortunate situation that I could give a lecture, so I just want to give two, three sentences for the starting of the discussion. I think we should define 5 to 10 diseases where modern Western medicine has difficulties.
And of Ayurveda, Kerala. And as a child, Ayurveda was not very much appreciated by me also as a young kid. In those days, yes, Ayurveda is not a real medicine. It takes long time to cure and all. It's not the, instant, there is no relief and all. But one thing I wanted to, we always felt, it's almost thousand years now it is sustaining. If Ayurveda is not doing good in that context, and this popularity has made it much worse now, because it's a tourism, important aspect of tourism in Kerala, Ayurvedic tourism. And that has diluted its, its quality of treatment and all, its massaging oil and all sort of things, it's much more popular. And that's one aspect to be taken care of because it is being commercialized. But it has sustained for hundreds of years means that it is one of the most potent, medical practice. But at this moment, yes, many hospitals are trying to integrate Ayurveda with allopathic medicines. Vedanta in New Delhi, Dr. Trihan is a eminent cardiologist. He has, there's a holistic approach, adding allopathy with, Ayurveda. So it is not the question. Now it has to be taken care of very seriously, that how we can integrate our basic traditional medical practices with the modern practices. And Dr. Martin, yes, I was shocked because we have the Ayurveda, land of Ayurveda originated here. And Dr. Martin had to tell us that how it has been integrated. In India, yes, we have not done uniform research, we are guilty of it. Dr. Mohan Rao mentioned, Dr. Valiyathan, yes, he has started the initial point, but it's not being taken, because the political level, at the government level, the decision has to be taken. I remember because we started the Tropical Botanical Garden Research Institute in Kerala with a special purpose because it's a land of, diverse plant commit systems and where Ayurveda was flourishing. And with a plan that every district will have, or a taluka will have medicinal plants garden. And that garden may tell people also, how it can generate more and more, resources for the people also, as well as it will help the industry also. Modern medicine also needs plant extraction products. But that too did not take off. We have this piecemeal arrangement in our country. Somebody starts, it takes off, it's not being appreciated. The next director came for Tropical Botanical Institute, Trivandrum. He has his own ideas. We don't have a real policy matter. So that is exactly what has to be taken care of. Today's meeting of the years, as Dr. Sunil said, that the opinion of the panel and the house will be sent to the Government of India for consideration. One or two points that is, you remember, neem. Neem has been patented in USA, saying that they have discovered the effect of neem. For generations, hundreds of years, this has been used in India for different purposes. It's a gift in humankind. And they have patented it. Once they patent, you should know that we cannot use on our own, we have to buy it from the sunrise industries. And to Government of India had to send $1 million in the American courts to set aside this patent. Number two, healthy, the curcumin principle. Some university scientists in USA said, yes, we have discovered the medicinal principles of curcumin. This has been used hundreds of years in India itself, as a child, we remember when there's an injury that healthy was being used. So there is a serious concern now because in the globalized world, there is patenting world, which is going to be. Patenting is a norm now. So all the medicinal principles of all the Indian plants has to be taken care of, and we have a Herculean task, almost like human genome project. Because we have such diverse plants in this country, and all these medicinal principles has to be identified, it has to be patented. We cannot say that we are not going to do it, it's our own generations, it is our own origin. It's ours. It's a traditional knowledge of ours. We cannot help it. We may have to fight it out in international courts. How long and how far? Which else plan? What else you will do? So it's a high time, yes, yes, this is CMB has taken it up. I know, but the slow pace, the slow progress, it has to be an all India coordinated, it's a Herculean venture to identify the medicinal principles of all the plants and identify and complementing them with the modern medicine and Ayurveda combined. I think this is most important. I personally had been thinking about this in these lines, and the government has to do quite a lot about it. Thank you very much.
You know, first of all, if you want to adjust, you know, first we have to prove that we adjust. So at least, you know, this is a good message. Never is better, you know, never is better than late. Late is better than never. Right? So at least now we are accepting that Ayurveda is, and it exists. Professor, you said that we have to find the principles of all the plants. What are those all plants? Do we know? The fact is, we don't know. In this country, this country is very rich in biodiversity. The number of medicinal plants which are there in this country are nowhere in the world. But we don't know what we have. So what does it mean? It means that we don't have the database. Forget about the molecular markers and biochemical identifications and all these things. We don't even have our own morphological databases which are written in our old books. And believe me, everyone keeps citing Charak Sangita, this book, that book. And if I want to have the real original book, probably it is difficult to find it. And if I buy it from somewhere, probably I'll end up buying a duplicate version of it, right? So all the plants need to be tested for biochemical properties, medicinal properties. When we want to reach to that point, before that, we have to identify the ways to know what are those all plants. This is the next point which I would like to highlight. Comments, please.
I would like to add a few points to the work that Martin initiated. In most cases, in fact, in the morning discussions also we have seen, people think or have a misconception that the Ayurvedic medicine works very slowly or not. Is it so? When we go to the Ayurvedic temple, we use allopathic medicine for a few years and all, and then we don't get a cure, and the disease worsens, goes to a stage that it requires medication over a long period. At that stage, we usually get fed up with the allopathic medicine and then go there. This is what usually happens. No one is an exception. At that time, Ayurvedic doctor prescribes according to its own principles and all, and you use it for a few months or a year and say that no, it's not working, we jump over to another person. Probably that was one reason why we are getting this kind of misconception that Ayurvedic principles or Ayurvedic system of medicine works very slowly. That's what I just wanted to add upon. And second thing is, do we really know, identify what kind of plants that were described in the old text, can we identify? We identify. You go to the Vasarajiyam, the 900 pages book, which I think many people who know who can speak the vernacular language, Telugu language, can be knowing it. Vasarajiyam is the one which you will find in any of in the old textbooks. Can we identify? Can we say that this is this plant? No. We need a proper botanist who can, a taxonomist who can authenticate it, that this is this. We do not know that. That was the reason. One is that one, most of the plants got extinct. Another thing is we generally do not go deep into the subject and then leave it at that point, go for an alternate thing. This is one kind of a thing. Because of the reason that the text, whatever we see, no one wishes to go back to the library and then see. Suppose you see some of the old texts which were digitized and kept in the archives, internet archives, if you can download some of the works, Bhagavata's so-called Ashtanga Sangraha, you can download all the pages which are there in the local language, in Telugu itself, in Telugu script itself, with the meaning. Sloka along with the Patipadartha and then the meaning. And I do not know how many Ayurvedic, students or research scholars are reading that one. The third point which I just would like to add upon is, as Professor Martin told, that identifying a disease areas where the Ayurvedic, the allopathic medicine is failing or fails. For example, in certain disease areas like psoriasis, neurological disorders, they have the medication, but there is no cure. Particularly for psoriasis, if you see, we start with many of the salicylate preparations, go there towards methotrexate, and then go for the disease modifying, and then go to the TNF alpha blockers, and then antibodies. There we end. We block the TNF alpha, we invite the infections. Our immune system completely suppressed. And then, when entire things, at the last stage, we go and then seek the help from Ayurveda. So, I suggest that psoriasis is one, and similar thing is I myself have seen in certain neurological disorders, Ayurvedic principles, the kind of panchakarma which have been described in the morning also, they are highly useful. I have seen people recovering who are there in the vegetative condition where some mistake or the other, there is a complete embolism in the brain. People are lying vegetating on the bed, and I have seen people recovering. At least some of the movements, at least they quality of life was improved. So I feel that in some dermatological conditions and in neurological conditions, Ayurvedic science helps a lot. So these two areas I just wanted to suggest in this panel.
Friends, we are going to make the roadmap. But thing is that what are the existing roads? We must see this. Without the existing roads, further where we go, we may not be ready. As Dr. Martin told that, we can identify some 5 to 10 diseases, and then we come for the further plans, what we can do that. Now India is not a small country, it's a mega biodiversity country, has got 45 to 47,000 of plants, medicinal plants, as I mentioned, more than 8,000 which are commonly used. But which are the particular medicinal plants we'll be using? That's very important. We cannot take all of a sudden to all. I have some basic thing here, what Dr. Nambi told. Ayurveda, there is no doubt. Ayurveda, such a long time it has existed, and still now it is being more domain. All over the European countries and all, they are taking. So no doubt about it. But thing is that, which are the particular plan for which disease we can do the road mapping? That is to be narrowed down in such a way so that what can be done. Now in this case, I put in my own example. I had jaundice in 1999. So this doctor, he told you have to be in the hospital, otherwise I cannot do that. But my wife told, no, we will not keep you in hospital. So I went to a Papanasham, there is a place called Papanasham in Tamil Nadu. A lady, 105 years old lady, I came to know about her. I went there, she told you wash your hands and everything and then come. He gave me a small bit of plant material and he told me to swallow it. So, but she gave a caution, you should not take sugarcane juice and drink coconut. But I did that because other people are telling this during jaundice, this is very effective. But when it aggravated me further, again I went there, she gave, aapne to ye kaam kar liya. So this is a wrong thing you have done. Again, I am giving you things. Then after that, I could become all right. But thing is, what I'm telling is, I could identify the plants what she was giving. That is called a Phyllanthus singambattiana athu chedi. Why this particular plant I'm talking, why I'm specifically to narrow down the limitations. Athu chedi or Phyllanthus singambattiana, it comes only in river bed, that too in the world, only at Tamrapanni river it comes, right? But this particular Phyllanthus singambattiana, which I have already shared with Dr. Verma, has got 19 alkaloids of different things and gives tremendous medicines for hepatitis as well as for the cancer. Now this, it is in a small place. Now India, where the endemic plants, 5,700 endemic plants, many of them are medicinal. Taxol, that is Texas Bacata, as I told, as Dr. Chandrasekhar also told, it keeps the medicine of cancer, uterus cancer. Now, this is also a endemic plants to India. Like that, we have series of plants. For that, as I have given you a biograph website, you can see there are plants which are endemic and narrowed down to this. I request this panel can restrict to a certain group of plants which are endemic to this country, and we are specific to the diseases. And one thing I must share here is, with the Ayurveda, plants are more getting more problem, because more of the Ayurveda, more of the plants will be using, is it not? So in that case, we must restrict, and also the system where the plants are, why the plants are, even the medicinal plants, life-saving drugs, plants are getting destroyed. Why? What is to be done? I request this panel to also consider how to make some sort of a recommendations to the government. This is one. And these recommendations, if writing, just somebody as writing, is not giving any value to that. In this case, the scientific institutes like CCT, scientific institute like CCMB, the findings from the scientists from here certainly has got a, it will get a good validity from government of India and the entire country. And I feel the German part of our, the panel discussions, it will have more weightage. So this is a second point. And third point, as I told, 75% of the country's plant biodiversity are not explored at all. Biochemical analysis, what we are thinking, molecular analysis, what we are thinking, 75% when it has not been explored at all, which of the plant we select for doing this work? There also, it needs to be narrowed down to a certain point. So what we proved, our roadmap should be such, limited but very authenticated and qualitative, so that the people after getting these, oh, this is the group has done wonderful work, and we must do further. So that gives, taking a big work, quantum of work, not with the quality, that may not give us the results as we expect. So this is a scientific institute, so I mean joined. And so this is almost the thing. So I told here, so this is, as Dr. Ramakrishnan told, whole thing, and my friend Martin has really opened our eyes. You see, a man from Germany studied the Sanskrit and gone through the Indian literature. Saraka, as one thing, such a wonderful thing he has done. So my son, being a part of the panel, I feel the policy what country is lacking today. As I told you, 1972 Wildlife Protection Act has got the 6 plants. 85% of the plants it goes from the forest, 15% is cultivated. 43 years after that, still the 6 plants it remains there. Therefore, the recommendations from this group, even it goes for the little bit of policy analysis also, I think it will be nice enough, it will be in the press. So with this, I conclude here. Any further things we'll discuss from there.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, everybody. Before we discuss about the roadmap for modern research on medicinal plants and the Ayurveda system for 2020, all these synthetic drugs, though they appear to heal very fast, they all of them are associated with side effects, a lot of side effects. However, why we consume these drugs is, it is better to live a little long with side effects than die. Regarding this Ayurveda or Indian traditional medicine system, many of the things were not really documented. The reasons are, our ancient Indians, they do not have any commercial interest. So they were least interested in patenting or owning those techniques. So they were not really well documented. Even later, people, when they realized that we need to have a patent protection, otherwise people from other countries will take our knowledge and they may sell to us, we have to buy our own knowledge. By that time, you know, basmati, turmeric which has a wound healing effect, and also neem tree, products of neem tree, all of these things, very popular traditional knowledge systems, were tried to patent in out of India, but we fought and we proved that these systems have been used centuries ago, and it is our knowledge. For the information of all the students, in CSIR, that is Council of Scientific and Industrial Research, that is our parent organization of CCMB and IICT, we have a department, full-fledged department, that is Traditional Knowledge Digital Library. The task of this department is to translate all the knowledge available in local languages like Tamil, Telugu, Northeast languages, Hindi, whatever it is. Because international patenting office, they don't know these languages, they know only English. So their task is to translate all those books, or they discuss with those tribal people or village people, and they get the information from them, which plant or which product, which herb is useful for which disease. They document in English, then they digitalize and they put in a database. So now India has a database of Ayurvedic or medicinal plant database in Traditional Knowledge Digital Library, which CSIR is maintaining. So this prevents other country people patent our own ancient knowledge. Second thing is, in Government of India, we have a full-fledged department or ministry of Ayush. That is, Ayush is the Ministry of Ayurveda, Yoga, Yunani, Siddha and Homeopathy. So all these alternative medicine systems, we have a department. So they have a lot of research centers on each of these. For example, you know, yoga, we have International Yoga Day also now. So whole world knows what are the good effects or good health effects of yoga. So now when it became international, we started doing yoga, though it has been known since ages. Similarly, Ayurveda also, several people started practicing. As Dr. Ramakrishna indicated, many people come to alternative systems when they fail to cure from the modern medicine. So that becomes a frustration, and then even these alternative medicines also will take some more time to cure. So they think that it is a failure of the alternative medicine rather than the failure of the actual immune system, whatever is in the body. So Ayurveda, we have 21 research centers in India. For Siddha, 6 research centers. Yunani, we have 18 research centers. And homeopathy, we have 26 research centers. Fortunately or unfortunately, all these research centers are associated with hospitals. So they deal with patients and the cure, but not with the new medicine. So what is the focus of this conference or today's DAD-funded conference is that we have to really relook into the combination of medicines like modern medicine and the plant-based or Ayurvedic medicines and find an effective drug for diseases. So now I would like to say a few very important things about what is IICT's contribution towards this area. As our director had already mentioned, we have a complete one full department, that is natural product department, natural product department, and we also have established a national mole bank. This national mole bank has been established. It's a unique facility in the country, established in 2011 with the support of Department of Science and Technology and CSIR. And it can store up to 1.2 million molecules. See, anywhere in India, any laboratory, they synthesize a molecule or they isolate a molecule from the plant product or whatever natural product, they can send those molecules, those compounds to our facility. We can store all those molecules for years together at minus 20 degrees centigrade. So at present we have a capacity of storing 1.2 million molecules. The reason why I am stressing this is when 1.2 million molecules can be stored, anytime any biologist who is expert in screening the molecules for any disease, they can get the data, what is the formula of the compound, what is the structure of the compound, from where it is isolated, what is the source of it. So all data is available with us. So anybody, any biologist can take a sample and screen the sample after 10, 15, 20 years also. So because it is very expensive and unique facility, we are the only people having that facility. And I would like to share this information with you. And lot of molecules which have been already, 20,000 molecules have been already stored in the facility, and many molecules have been tested for anti-TB and anti-cancer activity. And with these activities in CSIR IICT, we also have collaborations with the CCMB. We are working together to find out new molecules for diseases like TB, cancer and other diseases. Thank you very much.
Plant to you with that kill. From that you have to extract the molecules and put it. I think in India there's a great potential from educated people, from institutions, and what I see, but I see only the Ayurvedic research part, that the methodology is not on the international level all the time. So the institutions are there, all the educated people are there, but I think that some special training is needed. And maybe bringing now these institutes here, which are focused on modern science, bringing them together with the Ayurveda scene, with the clinicals, with the hospitals, that they can really learn from each other. I think this is very important to have this. And maybe international partners can help in this process because some mediation can be done. And as I told you personally, it's an international network of Ayurveda research has started. It's a small network up to now, but we have to bring all these this knowledge together. And then I think we have really great chance. Because you see, if somebody is doing an Ayurveda study and only 7 patients are there, so how to do statistics? So there's a fault in it. So, and it's sad because it's a young person doing his master's or PhD, but the whole methodology is not on the right level.
So this is very important to have this.
That the capacity building program is needed, and where the India and Germany can collaborate to fill the gaps for each other. Where Germany is strong, we can learn from them, and where we are strong, we can have scholars from Germany to share the knowledge. So that is one of the points our scholars can write for writing the reports. And as Dr. Sarkar said, that we have to identify some plants and we have to deep down the research on them. I agree with that. Having said that, we must not forget that, you know, we have so many unexplored wealth, and we don't want to face a situation where someone comes with medicine A and we say, oh, I was working on medicine B, otherwise I could have discovered medicine A also. Yeah, this is one. Number two, even if we don't do all the discovery ourselves, at least we should be in a position to claim our rights. And if we don't know what we have, we can never claim our rights. So I agree with the point that we have to deep down our research on certain molecules or certain plants which we, the scholars, experts, can identify and join the hands together to do the basic research in the modern science and typical Ayurvedic methods. While we do that, we definitely have to have the database for the wealth which we have. If not the complete, full-fledged, well-defined database, at least some database, so that if someone else do something great on something which is there in our database, we could at least claim our right. And I must tell to all the scholars sitting here, international treaties are in place. There is a consortium of more than 180 countries, CBD. Dr. Sarkar can tell you more about it. And they have been discussing on the multilateral benefit sharing mechanisms since couple of years. And they say that the countries where we cannot afford having the laboratory, like Uganda or some South African countries, you know, or some countries, poor countries, but they are very rich in the natural traditional knowledge. They heal, they survive because of that knowledge, but they cannot do the research. They cannot afford, they don't have money to have big buildings and big laboratories. They are not in that position. So if we take the knowledge from them, so how they will benefit from that knowledge? So we go there and take the knowledge, convert that knowledge into the molecule or drug. So how do they get benefit? So the consortiums and the organizations like CBD, they are discussing and making the international treaties where the poor countries or the countries which are rich in the traditional knowledge, if they share their knowledge and if it is converted into some commercial product, that benefit will be shared with the country. But again, there is a condition there, and which is very tricky condition. I was asked to give opinion on that by CBD, and the next meeting is planned in Canada. So I have sent my points, and I was very plain in writing. These points seems very fair. They look very, very fair, very clear. But let me tell you, the country who cannot afford having the modern research laboratory to explore the wealth which they have, they probably cannot also fight legally with the people or with the countries who take their knowledge and don't return anything back to them. Okay? So how you make sure that this will not happen? And until you don't make this, until this, you ensure this on behalf of those countries, your policy cannot be implemented, and it will be implemented only for those countries who are on the upper end. So if you want to be really fair, you have to make a policy and make sure that everyone benefits. Having said that, we in India at least are in some better position. This is a big country, we are not so much poor, we have so many research laboratories, we have advanced centers of research, and we can afford having the at least our own database, and which we could say this is our wealth. Okay, now you want to explore this wealth, deep it down, you are welcome. But let us share the benefit. And we must be in a position to legally claim the rights on that kind of wealth. Examples are there from the past, Haldi, Neem. So how many? And these are two examples which everyone know. But believe me, there are many others which never come into the light. Right? So my opinion will be that while we focus on some specific molecules from some specific plants, we must have our own database, and not only the taxonomical database, club that database with some advanced techniques like molecular database, so that no one could even say that it is ours by mistake also. Okay? So I tell you my own experience. I was of your age doing my master's. And fortunately, I was doing my master's through a program from JNU, Master's in Biotechnology, from one of the best universities of India, located at Pantnagar University. So admission in that department was through JNU. And I was supposed to do my master's thesis. So I decided in 1994 or 5, I decided to do my master's thesis on basmati rice. And basmati rice also, DNA fingerprinting of basmati rice, for identification of basmati rice. So there was only one professor in entire university who could have helped me to do this, who could have guided me to do this work. And he was sitting in the genetics department in College of Agriculture. I was studying in some college which is bigger, you know, biotechnology, you know where. And I'm a student from biotechnology going to College of Agriculture to do thesis. All my teachers were upset. They said, "Tumne to hamari naak katwa di." Either say means they come to us and you are going there. I said, "Look, this is not college or something. I want to do something which I want to do, and you guide me, I will do it." So anyway, I did the DNA fingerprinting of basmati rice. That work I did in 1995, published in 1999, and that was the time when there was a dispute between India and US on the basmati rice. I still remember, emails were not there in those years. And Professor Applin from Germany, yes, or Netherlands, I forgot. One of the big professors, his name was Professor Applin, you can do the Google. He was reviewing my paper. And I got the comments by surface mail, it used to come by letters, you know, 2 months it used to take. That your title of your paper is Random Amplified Polymorphic DNA Analysis of Indian Scented Basmati Rice. And please remove the word Indian because there is a dispute. So I wrote a letter. I'm sorry, I can't do that. Because I collected the genetic material from the farmer's field in India, I never went to US. So I'm okay. So if you want to accept it, great. Otherwise, it's your choice. That paper was published as such in 1999 in one of the German journals of presses. You go back and do the PubMed search and you say basmati rice and DNA. My paper is the first in entire PubMed. Basmati rice and DNA. My paper is the first. In 2003, when I was writing my next patent, I met the head of the patent division of CSIR, Dr. R.K. Gupta, in the guest house of IICT. And I was just praising him, that sir, you are great, because he's the man who fought the patent for Haldi. Alright? Dr. R.K. Gupta, he was one of the members in that team. You are great, so you fought this patent for us. And Basmati Raj patent, you fought for us. He said, yeah. There was a paper, it really helped us. I asked him what was that paper. And by that time I became scientist, okay, in CCMB. He said it was some paper from some university on basmati rice. They did some DNA based work on basmati rice. I said, was it Khanna and Verma? He said, yes, it was Khanna, Verma. I said, I am Verma. And yeah, that was the time we became friends, and till now we are friends. He retired, he is very elder to me, but we are friends. And then I came to know that what is the importance of modern science if we mix with something like subject like agriculture, traditional medicine, Ayurveda. If we mix our modern science in these subjects, it becomes very powerful. And that is required. So with these words, I definitely emphasize that if not deep down research on our wealth, at least the documentation of it must be started. And that's how we, that's where we want to reach in 2020, so that we have a database by that time, and then we can decide what wealth we want to use. Either we want to use all of our wealth ourselves, or we want to share it, or we want to do it in collaboration, or we want to just hold it for some more time and we will think about it, but we must know what we have.
See, I have talked about a plant. I don't remember the name of the plant at the moment. The tribals in the high ranges in Kerala, they have a traditional, the name of the plant is pacha, green. And, you know, in the October, November, December, it's high cold over there. And they just take this, the bits of this plant extract, and they don't feel cold. So that's how, you know, when you go there, you may have to be covering with blankets and all, or high sweaters, woolen and all. They don't feel the cold. So Tropical Botanical Garden Research Institute in Kerala, they decided, yes, why not to, I mean, have some work on that. And they have collaboration with Ayurvedishala at, you know, Ayurvedishala in Coimbatore. And they have agreed, yes, we'll share the profit with tribals in high range in this product. And they made some money, and the money was never reached the tribals. And this is how we, you know, the faith is being lost. So they may sometime will hide the knowledge from others. They don't trust us. See, because it is their own original, I mean, their patent, I would say. Yes, it is theirs. We never had an idea about it. So there are such very special plants and plant extracts, plant molecules in some of the plants already, and most of the tribals, they have very real knowledge about it because they have been practicing for almost hundreds of years. And they are not ready to share with us unless we have a, I mean, the faith in between them, and you know, a lot of things will be lost otherwise. There is a whole lot of knowledge in the traditional medicine. And finally, yes, for me, there is nothing like an alternate medicine or traditional medicine. We have only one medicine, and we have Ayurveda. It's an integrated medical approach. Allopathy along with Ayurveda should complement each other.
Argupachani, and the scientific name is Trichophos jailanica. The Kanni tribes of Tirunelveli as well as Kerala part, while they walk long distance, they just take some fruits. It's a small, and they never get hungry or they never get cold. So from there, they made the patenting. And the money what it came to hard from this. But friends, we have the tribals, all the first years covered with the tribals. If we can connect these two things, their knowledge, traditional knowledge, and the plants, I think we can do a lot of things. Anyway, last point I'm telling is how to. Yes, the roadmaps, how it's to be done, I'm just narrowing down. Charaka Sanghita has got 341 plants. What we can do is from there, we can minus the common plants. Common plants in the sense which are globally available. So then from there, we come back to Indian origin plants, means plants which are endemic to this country. And then from there, we come to the Ayurveda diseases, what you mentioned, and then traditional knowledge data. We just collect these two, and then we come to the place called threatened list of the plants. It has been given by IUCN of Indian origin, which are threatened. So you see, from 340 minus the global plants, then comes to original, I mean the Indian origin, comes to Ayurveda disease, and then come to the traditional knowledge of our tribal people and the local people, then come to the threatened list of Indian plants, which has been authenticated by the IUCN, and then from there, we come to the whatever existing rules, that is 1972 Wildlife Act has got 6 plants. We can take this one of the these few 6 plants out of them. We can take it. And that still we are not in the country. And Dr. Parma already started with the 5-6 plants. Then we do have negative listing of the plants by Trade and Commerce Department. There are 21 plant species, name is already there available. And then one is family, that we cannot do, that is ambiguity. And 7 is general, that also we cannot do anything. So these 21 plants again have stopped. Then lastly, National Biodiversity Authority, head of which is Chennai, they have identified 132 plants, and it has been gazette notification they have made. So this again becomes the nearest town to that. And then we have the CITES, that is 1976, they have identified appendix 1, 2 and 3. From there also it comes. With that, the CCMP, my proposal, what I'm thinking, CCMP and IICT, and with the capacity building capacity of Germany, Dr. Martin, we can do something with that roadmap can be prepared. Thank you very much for this. Thank you.
How many of you are watching local Telugu Gemini TV every day in the morning, 8:30 to 9? There is one Kerala couple, they take one plant every day. They explain the all medicinal values of that plant, leaf, flower, fruit, root, whatever. All the parts of the plant, he explains what are the medicinal properties of medicinal values of each part of the plant. He also talks to some patients who got cured with his suggestions. It's a very important program. Every one of you should watch and at least note down and follow those points. This is my request. Thank you.
Everyone,
again,
that we must already, list is actually already worked out. Dr. Sarkar informs, and he himself has worked for more than 2 decades. And he has written the book Biodiversity Governance, which I say the Bible of Biodiversity Governance. So this book is very important, and the conclusions which you have given in this book, I think, must be taken further. And the modern science, whatever we want to do, that can be a beginning point. And also it describes the biodiversity methodology governance, how to basically note down the entire biodiversity. So he has described the methods. We can look into it, and we can agree upon European Academy of Ayurveda experts from there, and they can give opinion, and probably we can agree upon some common protocol. So this. And if from the audience, if someone wants to say something, you are welcome to say. Yeah, mics please. I give 5 minutes for the.
Think the negligence of Indians or whatever, it's not new to us. If you go back to the history, you will see that Jesse Bose, Acharya Jagadish Chandra Bose, he discovered the radio wave, but he didn't got the Nobel. Where Marconi Italian, he got the Nobel, whatever. I would like to suggest something. Which, if I keep the points what Dr. Sunil said, that all of our points are going to be sent to the policy makers or whatever the authority to Delhi or whatever to the government, then I would like to suggest that just 1 week before, one big conference was organized by CCMB, SBCI and FAOBMB, that is Federations of Asian and Oceanian Biochemists and Molecular Biologists. One scientist from Philippines, she was giving a talk how scientists can be entrepreneurs. And she was describing how they interact with the local lights and they collect some extracts from plants and all, and they make the policy such that the benefit reaches to the society so that those can be industrialized. At the same time, they also get the share of it. Number one. Now, number two, what I would like to say that if we really want, of course we want, that this we Indians, we are having rich cultures and source of everything, lot of things. So, for example, in nurseries or sometimes we used to read Ramayana and Mahabharata sometimes. In this way, we can try to deliver to the government that not forcefully, but it is, if it is possible to introduce some education like those Mahabharata, Ramayana and all, on this Ayurveda and all, which is ancient science, in the schools or somewhere, maybe in class 7th or 8th or standard. So, and at the same time, just one more thing. At the same time, being from a scientific institute, I'm from CCMB, if it is possible to organize video conferences with maybe president or scientific minister, because we know our president is very much interactive with students and all, so that would be a very good thing.
So, educational program. Excuse me for this. I'm Dr. Amna Reddy. I'm a principal of a dental college. The reason I'm here is my friend is a traditional Ayurvedic physician and he has got some wonderful therapies. I think for the last 15 years, he has treated hundreds of patients. One of the drugs is also patented also. But what we are finding is trying to take it to the end point, that is, you know, to the patients, you know. Because what we're finding is we are unable to generate. We have put in a lot of our personal money. We are individual researchers at a personal level. We are not in any institute. This is a traditional Ayurvedic knowledge which he has got, and he has got some wonderful therapies. What we are finding problem is trying to go through the traditional route, because you know allopathic route, we know that, you know, phase 1, 2, 3 and there. For Ayurvedic products, what do we do, and what is the area for individual researchers? I don't know whether it's the right forum if you could address this, you know, where do we go for funding for individual researchers? And what is the route map or something, if you can answer, or otherwise outside also, if you have time, I'll try to meet you. And there is no central international funding agency, because I think some products, like herbal products, Ayurvedic products, it's great that he has done some work in, you know, since he was there in an institute, he could do that. What for people who are there outside, we have traditional knowledge, people are discussing about tribals and all. I have the knowledge, where can I go to get some funding? I know it is working because he has treated last 10-15 years. What do you do? You know, is there any place where I can go? And I'm a traditional allopathic practitioner. I'm a maxillofacial surgery. I'm heading an institute. I'm running from pillar to post. I've gone to IICT. I've gone to most of the institutes. My problem is funding. Where do I go? I think if you can address this later also, it's fine. Thanks for the opportunity.
Thank you.
Good evening, sir. Krishna from Loyola Academy, UGM PG College from Secunderabad. I would like to do a small correction in the debate. Somebody from the eminent personality said that we are lacking documentation regarding this traditional medicine, and in fact, we have everything in our system, Indian system scenario, but the problem is that is there in Sanskrit. And if I am not wrong, there are no people, efficient people who can translate into actual, you know, that's language nowadays. We need some people who have a lot of hold on this Sanskrit. Second thing, as somebody pointed on this, lot of need is there for building this taxonomies in botany. Why? Because unless we know the common scientific name of that particular plant, we cannot retrieve the data from the Googling or somebody else. Yes, thank you.
Palamuru University, Department of Botany. So, as a botanist, in the traditional knowledge, especially I am giving one small suggestion, with no medicine. So, because our university is located in rural area, even when I approach to the rural people, villagers, or forest related with the people, I got so many new findings. Their formulation, also search in Google or other documents, there is no reports. Like that, so many reports I have got. So kindly, you add this point in your panel, sir, because the documentation is needed, of course, that to be needed at village level. Because one thing I have seen, the documentation published data is there, sir, one thing.
You are saying community involvement. Yeah. I take your point.
Okay.
Yeah. So now I think we...
Thank you, sir, giving this opportunity.
So we are... Someone has to conclude. So with the few points which are discussed here, I will be very brief and just to the point. And all students can please make a note of it. We have discussed that we have to focus deep down into some of the plants which are very important and the products, and also we discussed about making of a database. It could be a taxonomy based database or an advanced database based on molecular markers or something. Then IRCT has very big national facility to reserve and keep the molecules, so probably this will be one of the big resource for the people who will be joining the hands in this endeavor. And Professor Martin said that capacity building program is important, and I agree with that fully. And capacity building can be two-way program, India to Germany and Germany to India, and for which of course we have to find the ways and define the policies and means of doing it. It could be DAAD, it could be some other international or Indian funding agency. Then someone from the audience raised very good point that video conferencing and educational program for awareness need to be done, and also the community involvement, because without the involvement of the community, and they may be uneducated people actually, this program cannot be complete. Also the point was raised to have the knowledge into the common language, and rather than some difficult language like Sanskrit. On this I would like to say that if a scholar from Germany who has nothing to do with Hindi and Sanskrit can read in Hindi and Sanskrit in Germany, so probably the country of 120 million people should do some efforts, and definitely should not complain that our literature is in Sanskrit, and definitely we must, you know, together feel that this is also one of the language of this our country. And yeah, but of course, yes, there is a need to have a plan and educational system so that we know our language, rather than saying all the time that I don't know Telugu or I don't know Tamil or I don't know Sanskrit, I know only this language, so I need this knowledge only in this language. So that cannot be the excuse. We must have scholars in all the languages. Then Dr. Sarkar, extensive studies he has done, and he concluded some fine lists of the endangered medicinal plants, and probably the panel can have a look at that list, and if they feel, then some of the future collaborations could probably be started from some of the medicines or some of the plants described in that particular concluded list. So with these things, these points, I would like to conclude this panel, this session, and I would like to thank all the panelists, Professor Martin, Dr. Sarkar, and everyone. Special thanks to Professor Nambia, and he was the representative for all of you, the students. So very good suggestion for you, everyone. And this was a very interesting discussion. Our students were making notes of everything whatever was being discussed here, and some few points, 10 points or 15 points will be briefed, and they will be pinpointed, and probably the scholars and the eminent personality sitting here
will agree upon it and we will sign it. And let us see how we take it further. So with these words, I just say thank you to all of you for joining the discussions. Thank you, one and all.